Buddham Saranam Gacchami, Dhammam Saranam Gacchami, Sangham Saranam Gacchami.
The path of the Dharma began here in Lumbini, where Prince Siddhartha was born 7 centuries before the birth of Christ. His mother, Queen Maya Devi or Mahamaya, was on her way to visit her parental home when she developed labor pains. Thus, she gave birth to a baby boy here, which was a beautiful sultry garden then. And this pond is where Queen Mahamaya is believed to have taken a bath after delivering the baby boy. In the 3rd century BC, when the great Buddhist emperor Ashoka visited the Lumbini, it was a flourishing community. The remains of that community, especially its stupas and monasteries, are seen here even today. Emperor Ashoka erected this pillar to mark the place where the Buddha was born. Today, Lumbini is just across the border from India, in Nepal, a country which was the world's only Hindu kingdom until very recently. Lumbini has been neglected for centuries, but in recent years, this place has been renovated and developed by the Nepalese government, and it is now attracting large numbers of international Buddhist pilgrims. Many Buddhist pilgrims today travel from Lumbini across the border to northern India, where most places associated with the life of the Buddha can be reached by road. This is the town of Buddhagaya, the place which is identified as Uruvela in Buddhist scriptures. During Prince Siddhartha's time, this was forest land where hermits came to meditate and free their minds of worldly desires. But today, Buddhist pilgrims in their thousands come here each month to pay homage to the Buddha. It is under this tree that Prince Siddhartha sat in meditation and fought an epic battle against illusions for many days. Mara, the spirit of sensuous desires, disturbed him with pleasures of flesh and other temptations. He was able to subjugate the Mara eventually, and after many hours of profound meditation, he attained supreme enlightenment at the dawn of the full moon day in the month of Baisakha or Vesak, which falls in May. He thus came to be known as Gautama Buddha. Today, pilgrims from many nations come here to pay homage to him and his teachings, meditate and purify their minds. Buddhists believe that it is a meritorious act to visit this place at least once in their lifetime.
Buddha born and Buddha preach and Buddha walk in this land. Therefore, all over the world people, they want to see these original sites, the places. Because today you see Japan, China, Korea, Thailand, Burma, Sri Lanka, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, Singapore, Malaysia. This each and everywhere there are a lot of the Buddhist community, lot of countries that Buddhist countries. Therefore, from all over the world, they are coming to worship these places, to receive the blessings. Normally, you see as a Buddhist, their life, they have a wish once in life should go to Buddhist places.
This people or Bodhi tree is believed to be the third generation of the original tree under which Prince Siddhartha sat to meditate. A branch of the original tree was sent to Sri Lanka during Emperor Ashoka's time through his daughter Sangamitta. According to historic Buddhist legend, later a jealous wife of the emperor has cut off the tree because he was paying more attention to the tree. When the offshoot of it died a few centuries later, a branch of the tree in Sri Lanka has been cut off and planted here. This is that offshoot. The history of this imposing architectural masterpiece known as Sambhuti or Mahabodhi Temple is shrouded in obscurity. However, this temple is considered as one of the earliest temple constructions in India, and its architecture has influenced temple construction over the centuries, not only in India but other parts of Asia as well. This is also one of the earliest Buddhist temples built entirely in brick, still standing in India. In 2002, UNESCO declared this temple complex as a World Heritage Site. The Bihar state government has been encouraging foreign Buddhist nations to build temples and other facilities in the area, hoping to increase tourist revenues. In 2007, Bihar Cabinet approved a 25-year master plan to give an international look to Buddha Gaya. Thus, the Mahabodhi complex is surrounded by various temples and monasteries, which reflects the diversity of Buddhist temple architecture and traditions across Asia. This 80-feet high Buddha statue built by the Japanese is a great attraction for visitors. But the adjoining Buddhist temple is where the Dharma is practiced. Every evening, pilgrims come here to meditate in these peaceful surroundings. And across the paddy fields, this simple school made up basically of huts is where a local Buddhist monk is spreading the Buddha's message to the local community, most of whom are not Buddhists. Though there are not many Buddhists around the place the Buddha gained enlightenment, yet his teachings, the Dharma, is conveyed to the local community through schools like this one, run by Buddhist monks here.
When I buy the land here, then I said I should make this school here. The monks may request me to make the temple. I said no, because Buddha was born in under tree, and how can I make this temple for marble temple or granite stone? No need. When I burn the lamp, many things, lamp, light goes surrounding. Now the under there is dark. Darkness, I give no. When I make the school, I give the light to. Now, 15 years my school now, complete here. And I am very, very happy because I have many other religions, also Muslim, many students I have, and Hindu and Buddhist, Christian also. Now, I am very happy they understand very nicely in Buddhism.
What was the name of the king of Kapilvastu?
King Solan.
Because here, in this school, especially in English medium school, and in English medium school is very expensive now here. Education is very expensive here, 700 to 800 rupees per month. But here I get 3 or 4 or 5 years get free education. Teachers demand the money, salary. Then I says the student, you can pay. Then I call the guardians meeting. please help me. Yeah? Because how can I maintain the school, these teachers, they demand the salary. Then 20 rupees for nursery classes. And our big students, the 25 years. It's enough for me.
This is the banks of the river Ganges in Varanasi or Baranas, considered the most holiest place for Hindus, who believe each drop of its water has the power to purify the living and liberate the dead. Hindus from all over India come here in their thousands to be blessed by the priests who have ancestral rites to perform these rituals here and take a dip in the holy waters. For centuries, devout Hindus have come in their old age to live here until they die. Cremation by the banks and immersion of the ashes in the holy river Ganges, Hindus believe gives you moksha, the ultimate salvation from the cycle of birth and death. Just 8 kilometers from Hinduism's holiest abode is Saranath, where Gautama Buddha chose to preach his first sermon on an Asala full moon day, just 3 months after his enlightenment in Buddha Gaya. His first disciples were the 5 ascetics who have abandoned him earlier. Having attained enlightenment, he met his old friends on this hill, where the Chokhandi Stupa, built in the 5th century AD during Gupta period, stands today. He preached to them here the Noble Eightfold Path, thus setting in motion the wheel of the Dharma. During the Buddha's time, this area is known to have been a deer park. And in the 3rd century BC, Emperor Ashoka built this Dhammic stupa to mark the place of the Buddha's first sermon. Today, this is a place of pilgrimage for Buddhists from around the world. The stupa is 31 meters high and 28 meters in diameter. It is covered by beautifully carved symbols that depicts the Noble Eightfold Path. It has withstood attempts by Mongol Turkic invaders to demolish the stupa. This modern temple known as Moolagandhikuti Vihara was built in 1931 by the Mahabodhi Society and is based on the architectural style of the Mahabodhi Temple of Buddha Gaya. Every night, monks of the temple chant the Dharma Chakra Sutra, the Buddha's first sermon here. This is Rajgir or Rajagaha, one of the most ancient cities of the world. Rajgir means the royal abode and it has had many dynasties of rulers. This is the city where the Buddha is said to have met King Bimbisara, the ruler of the powerful Magadha Empire. After his sermons in Saranath, Gautama Buddha has come to Rajgir with over 1,000 monks of his new order. The king gave them this Veluvana bamboo grove to reside, which is today a pleasure park. Overlooking the park is Girdhagota Hill, one of the most sacred places in the life story of the Buddha. 16 years after his enlightenment, the Buddha assembled 5,000 followers and continued teaching the Dharma to them for 12 years. Many of the sutras, which contains the essence of the Buddhist teachings, originated here. King Bimbisara built this road to go up the hill to listen to the Buddha's sermon. And many centuries later, the Japanese have built this cable car to go up the hill and this peace pagoda or shanti stupa to mark the peaceful message the sermons from the hill conveys. Just 12 kilometers north of Rajgir is Nalanda. During the Buddha's time, Nalanda is said to have been an influential and prosperous town, thickly populated. Later, it became a famous monastic center of learning when Buddhism was at its peak in India. The Nalanda Mahavihara is believed to be a forerunner to the university education system we know of today. It flourished as a university between the middle of the 5th century AD to the beginning of the 13th century AD, when Nalanda enriched and disseminated Indian culture and especially Buddhism across Asia.
We find from the records of Master Xuanzang, you know, who visited this place in 7th century, talks about the grandeur of this wonderful university, a center of learning, where, you know, as per his records, you know, 10,000 monks were studying here. And the place was, you know, in such a harmony. And his record says that the actual site, you know, was almost 16 square kilometers. But what we have now at the moment, the excavated site is only 1.6 kilometer. So, you know, a lot of Nalanda is yet to be found.
From what we see in the ruins of Nalanda is a series of 11 monasteries and 5 temples lined up on either side of a stone-paved pathway. The temples facing east and monasteries facing west. These pathways also crisscross the entire complex. The university was considered an architectural masterpiece. There were many meditation halls and which were connected to each other with corridors, verandas and courtyards. The monasteries also contained living quarters for monks. In addition to the study of the Dharma, the Buddhist teachings, the students were also taught non-religious subjects such as surgery and mathematics. A few minutes walk from the main entrance is the Sariputra temple, the main temple of the Nalanda complex. This large stupa was built over the remains of Sariputra, one of the Buddha's closest disciples. It was originally built by Emperor Ashoka, but 7 times rebuilt since. This temple clearly has 3 levels and it also is believed to have contained a huge library. The University of Nalanda had around 15,000 monks, with around 1,500 of them teachers. When in 1205 AD, the marauding troops of the Mongol Turkic invaders put to the sword over 3,000 monks and burned its buildings and libraries. A fire which is said to have burned for 6 long months. Thus, a large collection of precious manuscripts were lost forever. Today, we are able to recollect the glory of Nalanda thanks mainly to the work of a great Chinese scholar monk, Xuanzang, who spent 12 years at Nalanda, both as a student and a teacher in the 7th century AD. He has written vivid memories of his time there. He returned to China with 657 volumes of sacred texts and spent his final years translating these and instructing fellow monks.
Xuanzang, we can say he worked as an archaeologist because, you know, he helped us in finding out the ancient Nalanda University, because if his records were not there, maybe, you know, we would not have known the Nalanda University as we know it today.
In appreciation of his unique contribution to the literature on the teachings of the Buddha and for the rediscovery of Nalanda, this memorial was officially opened in Nalanda on 12th February 2007. In 1951, the first president of the Republic of India, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, declared that the ancient seat of Buddhist learning at Nalanda will be revived in order to regain the lost glory and the heritage of the Nalanda Mahavihara. Since then, it has slowly but gradually developed into a modern state of learning, but reflecting the ancient Mahavihara principles, where monks and students lived together. Today, the library of the Nalanda Mahavihara is a two-story building with 16 research cubicles and two big reading rooms. Rare Buddhist manuscripts and personal notes are available here, and Buddhist countries across Asia have donated books. Thus, volumes of the Tripitaka, the Buddhist canon in different languages, are stocked in the library.
We are trying to keep up the tradition, reviving the old values, but it is open to all.
At the peak of Nalanda's glory, Buddhism was perhaps the major religion in India. But in the land of its birth, it is a minority religion today, mainly practiced by former low-caste Hindus. The city of Nagpur and its surrounding in Maharashtra state is somewhat unique, in that Buddhists make up a slight majority in this area. It is mainly due to the efforts of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, the law minister of the first post-independence Indian cabinet and the architect of the Indian constitution. Born a low-caste Hindu, he died a Buddhist after converting to the religion with over 500,000 of his followers here in 1956.
In 1935-36, Dr. Ambedkar announced that though I am born as Hindu, it was not in my hand where to born or in which religion to born, but I will not die as a Hindu. And for 20 years he was studying what religion should be adopted for our people for the liberation. His thinking was Buddhism is originated in India. It is the only religion in India, in the world, which propagates liberty, equality and fraternity. My people need social liberation. Therefore, I should adopt Buddhism. And in 1956, on 14th October 1956, we call it Ashoka Vijayadashmi. On that particular day, he embraced Buddhism at this place.
Every year on 14th October, hundreds of thousands of Buddhists from all over India come here to pay their respects to Dr. Ambedkar. While some also take up robes on the day, most Buddhists in Nagpur live in poor communities like this, and their houses display the Dhamma Chakra symbol, perhaps in an attempt to divorce themselves from the caste system. Many Buddhist communities here do not have the luxury of a temple in the true monastic tradition with resident monks. At this Buddhist community in Kamla, a suburb of Nagpur, they open up and pray at the temple when they need to. There is no monk to conduct the ceremonies.
All those followers of Dr. Ambedkar were downtrodden, poor people. They are themselves contributing themselves for religion, and we haven't got any help from foreign countries. Prior to conversion, those who were known as scheduled caste, untouchables, they were having inferiority complex. They are less than some all the other peoples. But now, after conversion, everybody themselves feel that they are no less than anybody in the Hindu religion or in the Indian people. That is a great change in the people.